Welcome to EPG Pathshala. Today, I'm going to talk to you about the humanist method in social sciences. I am Shoma Chowdhury Lahiri from the Department of Sociology, St. Xavier's College, Kolkata. Now, the humanist method in social sciences is a part of a module from methodology of social research. Now, the humanist method emerged in the 1970s in the social sciences. It arose as a challenge, positivistic orientation in social sciences. And it found a resonance in different disciplines like philosophy, art, law, history, and so on. It also received reinforcement from various other theoretical schools in sociology, namely symbolic interactionism, ethnomethodology, and critical theory perspectives, which came later. Since the decade of the 1980s, sociological research methods have been characterized by a sense of methodological pluralism. Following Max Weber, social scientists have had a conception of the limitation of the scientific model in understanding the social. This was also reinforced by the symbolic interactionist, the ethnomethodological, and the critical theory perspectives that came afterwards. The humanist method challenged the positivistic approach to social sciences and asserted the unique character of human beings, both as subjects of social science and as social investigators. Gusfield mentions that the humanistic model draws from art, literature, philosophy, and history, and emphasizes the self-conscious, selecting, and unpredictable character of human action. Unlike science, the humanist methods avoid generalization. The emergence of the humanist method can be traced to the cultural and narrative turn in the social sciences, as well as in the arts and humanities since the decade of the 1970s. This period also marked a shift within sociology from an overly technical positivistic orientation to a form of social analysis which would be devoted to a service of humanity. Ken Plummer's Documents of Life can be considered as the central text in this turn towards biographical, narrative, and qualitative methodologies, which challenged and in due course changed the nature of research in sociology. In the introduction to his book Documents of Life, 1983, Plummer mentions four criteria of a humanistic sociology. Number one, it is a method which pays a tribute to human subjectivity and creativity, showing how individuals respond to social constraints and actively assemble social worlds. Second, it deals with concrete human experiences, talk, feelings, actions through their social and especially economic organization. It shows a natural and an intimate familiarity with such experiences. And fourth, a self-awareness by the sociologist of the ultimate moral and political role in moving towards a social structure in which there is less exploitation, oppression, and injustice. In other words, Plummer himself says that humanist research is one that gives prime place to human beings, human meaning, and human actions in research. Though the reflection of a humanist orientation is found in a wide range of fields within sociology, humanist research is used to analyze the active construction of meaning in people's lives. It employs field research, life stories, and other forms of qualitative research, drawing from a variety of sources like literature, biographies, narratives, case studies, photography, and films to provide a close and intimate familiarity with life as it is lived. Humanist research generally shuns abstractions and adopts a more down-to-earth, pragmatic approach. Although it places a lot of faith in human reason, it recognizes the role of emotions and feelings and puts great emphasis on ethical choices that men make in creating a good world. Different forms of personal documents are of central importance in humanist method. And I quote Plummer, "The world is crammed full of personal documents," unquote. People maintain diaries, write letters, take photographs, write memos, publish letters to editors, paint pictures, make music, and give expression to their cravings and desires through these objects, which are called documents of life. These documents of life constitute a remarkable diversity and are an unnoticed and yet persistent presence in our everyday life. They help in both understanding and shaping our social life. Over the last 30 years or so, Ken Plummer's Documents of Life 1983 and subsequently Documents of Life 2001 have become key texts which deal with the narrative and biographical turn in intellectual life and thus form the mainstay of the humanist method. In Documents of Life 1983, Plummer cites how, while writing the first major sociological life history, The Polish Peasant in Europe and America, published in 1958, Thomas and Znaniki say that, open quotes, "we are safe in saying that personal life records as complete as possible constitute the perfect type of sociological material, and that if social science has to use other materials at all, it is only because of the practical difficulty of obtaining at the moment a sufficient number," unquote. In fact, the life story of Ladek, a Polish peasant, arriving in Chicago from Poland, by Thomas and Znaniki, constitutes the first major use of the biographical method in sociology. There were also intensive life stories of delinquents by Clifford Shaw in Chicago in the late 1920s, studies of poverty and family life of people in Mexico and Puerto Rico by Oscar Lewis, films of organizational lives of schools, army, hospital, welfare, produced by Frederick Wiseman, to name a few. There are two things which are of importance here. First, it is remarkable to see that sociology was sensitive to life stories quite long ago. There was a moment in the history of the discipline, roughly between 1920 and 1935, when it seemed that documents would establish themselves as a central and significant sociological resource, but that moment seems to have passed. Hence, this style of research remained an outlier to mainstream sociological research till the mid-1970s to early 1980s or so. What was common to all these theorists is that they aimed to document and draw from the respondents' concrete experiences and ways in which they reconstruct meaning and make sense of their particular world. Secondly, in this context, it is perhaps important to recognize that despite the method that such methods were attacked on account of ignoring proper theoretical and structural concerns, they remained a thriving underbelly of sociological research. It is therefore not surprising that the significance of the humanist method is being realized only now, over the last decade or so. It is important to look at the various sources and their usage, which gives the humanist method its uniqueness. Number one, the diary. The diary is said to be a document par excellence, for it chronicles the flow of public and private events in a person's life and the ways in which it affects him or her. Each entry in the diary is sedimented into a particular moment in time, in the sense that they end up documenting an ever-changing present. Each day's entry does not merely signify that day's activities alone. If a diary is maintained in a sustained manner with sufficient dedication, the diary as a whole serves as a source of information and data for the sociologist. There are different kinds of diary entries which are useful to a sociologist. There have been attempts made by sociologists to ask the respondents to keep diaries as part of a statistical longitudinal study of adjustments to old age. Similarly, the gathering of logs and time budgets was a method used by Sorokin and Berger in 1938, whereby informants were asked to keep detailed time budget schedules that showed how time was allocated during a day. Another example of the usage of a diary was by Oscar Lewis in 1975, who studied Mexican families closely and intensively, but also decided to focus on the day as a unit of study for analytical purposes. This could be ensured by taking diary entries into consideration. Such entries facilitated intensive observation at a micro level. Sociologists have not only relied on diary entries as data, these have been followed by in-depth interviews of the person keeping the diary on each aspect that was documented. Plummer says that the above forms of diary, namely the requested, the log, and the diary-diary interview, where the social scientist solicits diaries from the respondents, are comparable to social scientists soliciting life histories. Just as the life historian could turn to pre-existing biographies to analyze, the diary researcher could also turn to pre-existing diaries. Letters. Letters, though relatively neglected as a source of information, are an important form of data. Thomas and Znaniki, in their book, The Polish Peasant in Europe and America, discovered the extensive use of letters between the Polish refugees to the United States and their relatives far back in Poland, which gave them an idea about the nature of family solidarity among the migrants, despite separation. They used letters inductively to arrive at a more general understanding of the subjective aspects of peasant society. Their work remains till today an example of a rather detailed and extensive use of letters. Citing Thomas and Znaniki, Plummer says in Documents of Life that letters perform five main functions. Number one, ceremonial letters sent on such familial occurrences as normally require the presence of all the members of the family, weddings, christenings, funerals, Christmas, New Year, Easter. These letters are substitutes for ceremonial speeches. Number two, informing letters, providing a detailed narration of the life of the absent member of the family group. Number three, sentimental letters, which have the task of reviving the feelings in the individual independently of any ceremonial occasion. Number four, literary letters, which have a central aesthetic function. And number five, business letters, when peasants resort to such letters only when distances are too great for an otherwise ubiquitous business in person approach. Peasant letters utilize traditional methods. The relative neglect of letters could be because they are hard to come by, though a lot of insights can be gained from them. Letter writing seems to be a dying art, and even when letters are sent, they are not preserved properly. They are usually thrown away. In fact, bundles of letters from one person to another for use by sociologists would be exciting documents, but it is quite unlikely that letters from both writers and recipients could be found. What is generally used as data in many cases today are the letters to editors of newspapers, journals, etc. Though letters are a source of information, social scientists feel suspicious about letters when they are available. This is because the letters speak of not only the writer's world, but also the writer's perception of the recipient. Thus, the story of the writer would shift depending upon the recipient. Hence, the social scientist needs to look at letters as an interactive product, always inquiring into the recipient's role. Another problem with letters is that they contain a lot of dross. They are generally not focused and hence are not of analytical interest always to the researcher. They move beyond the researcher's concern. Hence, in imposing order to cut out the dross, Plummer says that a form of hidden censorship and selective screening might be taking place by the researcher. The photograph. Photographs are another source of data in the humanist method. Just like diaries and life documents, photographs are also quite central in the understanding of middle-class life. In fact, as keeping diaries and letter-writing practices diminish, photographs begin to gain importance. Photograph as a source of data has been largely ignored by sociologists. It was only during the mid-70s that a group of American sociologists expressed interest as they organized exhibitions of their photographs and called it visual sociology. The inclusion of photographs as a tool of investigation has come primarily from the anthropologists, in particular the works of Gregory Bateson and Margaret Mead in 1942, who provided a volume devoted entirely to photographic images from the culture of the Balinese. Wagner, cited in Plummer 1983, suggests five modes of photographic research. Number one, as interview stimuli. Number two, for systematic recording of human phenomena. Number three, for sustained content analysis. Number four, for native image making. Number five, for narrative visual theory. Photographs are used as forms of documentation. They can be used to illustrate a text. A further way in which photographs may be used by social scientists is as a resource for further explanations. Thus, an account of the My Lai massacre was gained by Thompson in 1974, who interviewed respondents on the basis of photographs of the events. In Banish's work on city families in 1976, interviews were combined with photography. Families were selected by the researcher so that photographs could be taken of them as they wished to see themselves, and then the researcher went back to talk to them about photographs and to interview them about their hopes and aspirations. From this experience, one of the most apparent and popular methods in social science was discovered: to ask respondents for their family albums, to get a sense of their childhood relationships, friendships, family-related details, and so on. Photographs thus continue to be significant as they are effectively used by social scientists to create vignettes of individual and social life. With the humanist turn, their importance has been foregrounded. Film. Like photographs, films have also not been considered as significant by sociologists in their constructions of social reality till recently. More than sociologists or historians, it is the anthropologists who have been quite adept at using films to document and explain what they have been studying. At the start of the century, ethnographers started to film various tribal people engaged in social rituals. Subsequently, documentary films also started exploring lives of specific individuals from communities undertaken for study to reflect how individuals coped with various struggles of life. Though films have become an integral anthropological tool, Plummer says sociologists have either ignored the medium or used the documentaries created by filmmakers. The humanist method uses films which portray social institutions and the ways in which they impact lives on an everyday basis and also reflect the larger issues in a society. Life history and case study. The use of life documents lies at the heart of humanist research. Life stories are an account of a person's life in his or her own words. It is equally true that only some of man's experiences can be learned by observing his action. Life history can be gathered exhaustively of an entire life cycle of a social unit or a definite part of it. Whether a section or the whole of a life is studied, the aim is to ascertain the natural history revealing the factors that molded the life of the unit within its cultural setting. Because of its aid in studying behavior in specific, precise detail, E.W. Burgess had called the life history case study method the social microscope. Life history makes it possible to gather rich insight from personal and group life and use them for social analysis. Life history or case study is a research strategy that focuses on a single organization, institution, event, decision, policy, individual, or group. It attempts to investigate a contemporary phenomena within real-life contexts. Frederick Lipley is reputed to have introduced the method into social science. He used it as a handmaiden to statistics in his study of family budget. Herbert Spencer, an English sociologist, was the first to use case materials in his ethnographic studies. Later, Dr. William Healy, a psychiatrist, first adopted the method in his work with juvenile delinquents. After an intensive statistical study of 1,000 delinquents, he became convinced that statistics will never tell the whole story, as they in themselves are symptoms of unknown processes and can serve only as provisional grounds for sociological hypotheses. Life stories come through many sources: biographies, autobiographies, letters, journals, interviews, obituaries, etc. They can be written by a person as their own life stories or can be coaxed out by others. There are a plethora of terms by which life stories are denoted, namely as life stories, life histories, life narratives, autobiographies, autoethnographies, oral histories, personal testimonials, life documents, etc. Thus, life stories are a fairly complete narration of one's entire life experience as a whole, highlighting the most important aspects. According to Paul Atkinson, life stories are a product of collaboration. In the life story interview, the interviewee is a storyteller, the narrator of a story being told. The interviewer is a guide or director in the process. The two are together collaborators, composing, constructing a story that the teller can be pleased with. Thus, life stories are not simple accounts of a subject's life. They acquire a complexity in the way in which they are presented. There can be several forms of life stories, like a long life story and a short one. Long life stories could be seen as book-length account of a person's life narrated in his or her own words. A short life story takes much less time to construct and is more focused and is published as one in the series. At its richest, the long life histories draw from diaries, personal interviews with the subject's friends, a perusal of letters and other forms of communication by the subject. The first sociological use of the life history is credited to W. I. Thomas and F. Snanicki's massive The Polish Peasant in Europe and America, published between 1980 and 1920. It makes the claim that life histories are a perfect material for sociological research. Some very well-known ethnographic works in this genre are Paul Rudin, The Life of a Winnebago Indian, Vincent Trapanzano's Tuhami, The Portrait of a Moroccan, Marjorie Shostak's Nisa, The Life and Words of a Kung Woman, etc. Narratives. Narratives have gained a lot of currency in the social sciences in the recent times, so much so that today we speak of a narrative turn. Narratives have a close association with stories and have a fundamental way of giving meaning to human experience. Narratives have always existed, though anthropologists started noticing them and developed a critical attention towards them only since the 1980s. They became popular during the decade of the 90s, and today we find that it is widely used in a host of disciplines like anthropology, philosophy, law, history, psychology, sociology, and so on. This widespread usage is because it was felt that individual stories needed to be represented as evidence in sociology, as well as for deriving insights about the social world. Why are narratives important? Stories can provide a powerful medium for learning and gaining an understanding about others by affording a context for insights into what one has not personally experienced. They also provide a way of ordering experience, of organizing time, and of constructing reality. We come to make sense of the world by reading, listening, writing, and telling stories in particular ways. Narratives are temporal, meaningful, and social in character. They are produced for a specific audience and are often a result of a collaborative effort. There is an increasing recognition today of the role of the researcher in not merely recollecting but constructing narratives in a given context with biographical information. Narratives give space to different kinds of voices. For example, in medical anthropology, Arima Mishra and Suhita Chopra Chatterjee's work show how their narratives of health go beyond the patients and their immediate families to include traditional healers, midwives, practitioners of complementary and alternative medicine, health workers, and others, to show how culture and society play an important role in experiences of health, illness, and suffering in everyday lives. Jane Elliott mentions that the common theme running in the use of narratives is A. an interest in people's lived experiences and an appreciation of the temporal nature of that experience. B. a desire to empower research participants and allow them to determine the most salient themes in an area of research. C. an interest in process and change over time. D. an interest in self and representations of the self. E. an interest in the researcher himself as a narrator. In this way, narratives are used as an approach to understand social reality and lived experiences. Over time, Plummer went on to reflect on the nature of social science and found that there needs to be a renewed commitment of social science in moral and political projects. This new corrective endeavor he called critical humanism. Critical humanists view individual consciousness as the agent to empower, transform, and liberate groups from dominating and imprisoning social processes. Now, I go on to the utility of humanist logic in social science research today. The humanist method has far-reaching implications for sociologists all over, recognize and incorporate the values and ideas of this method in exploring and understanding social reality. The influence of humanist method can be seen in hermeneutics, grounded theory, ethnography in the form of thick description, visual sociology, use of focused group discussions, and in participatory rural appraisal, etc. In many studies in contemporary times, there is an attempt to use multiple methods using a humanist logic along with other methods to supplement. But though the humanist method has influenced social science considerably, it has been criticized on account of lack of objectivity, presenting an overly romantic view of human beings. Another criticism leveled against humanist method is that it works with a small sample, which in turn leads to limited generalization. But criticism notwithstanding, it continues to act as a subversive tradition to major scientific tendencies within social sciences. Therefore, as we just saw, the humanist method in social sciences arose in the 1970s and gained popularity in the 1980s and the 90s. It emerged as a critique of positivism, and it went on to emphasize the importance of human meaning, human actions, and experiences. It drew from a number of resources like literature, biography, history, and so on. And it had wide-ranging experiences, implications in the field of law, architecture, sociology, philosophy, art, and so on. Some of the main forms of sources of information that the humanist method draws from are called documents of life after Ken Plummer's intervention. And these documents of life are evidence like letters, diary, photographs, narratives, films, and so on. Now, although the humanist method gained currency in the 1970s and the 80s, we can see that the earliest use of biographical method in social science research can be traced back to 1920s and 30s in the work of Thomas and Slanicki on the Polish peasant. Since then, the humanist method has come a long way. Although it was disregarded in between years and decades, it emerged as an important method of qualitative research and is now incorporated in social science. Although the humanist method enjoys a very substantive degree of importance and currency, there are issues around which the humanist method is criticized. The two issues are of concern here. The first issue is over the lack of objectivity in humanist method, for it presents an overly romantic view of human life. And the second source of criticism is that it works with small samples, which prevents generalizations, large-scale generalizations. Despite the criticism leveled against the humanist method, it continues to be an important method of qualitative research used in the social sciences today.